Good morning. How's everybody doing today? All right, that's pretty good. It's not bad. I get it. It's, you know, 10 o'clock. And I like to wake up. It's cool. But I tell you, we got a lot to be excited about. And we're going to have to sing a bunch of fast-moving songs today. So hopefully it's a good thing to listen to and praise the Lord for what He's done. We're celebrating Resurrection Sunday. Now, technically, we're going to do more of our celebration on Passover next month. I'd like to have a meal here after service after a lunch after service. And most of the teaching about that, the importance of keeping the appointed time. That's not for us, it's a Jewish holiday, but appointed times are important because God appoints them. So we need to understand why they're important, why God appointed them, and what they mean, because they all have a symbolic meaning, and they mean a lot to these things. So I'm excited to have you here today. First time, God bless you. Thanks for coming in. And I tell you what, you're up for a treat, because God is good. His presence is here, which is the only thing that really matters. So, I want you to stand up. We'll get the lights in the damn pot. We're going to have to worship. And, congratulations. Let's hear the word today. Whatever you have need of, God's providing. I know sometimes it seems like it's not there. But sometimes it's just around the corner. You just have to press in a little bit harder. Just trust God just a little bit longer to make a way where there was no way. See, there are time and time again. We're in a unique time in history. We're in a special time that the whole world of the prophets, the apostles, and the people of long ago wanted to be a part of. And here we are today in these times. And it's important to go in with faith. Because we walk by faith and not by sight. Don't look around. Don't look at what you see. Don't be fearful You may see a storm raging. You may see a battle brewing. But the peace of God transcends all of that. I'll tell you, doesn't like the peace of God, amen. Peace in a storm, peace in a situation, just knowing who God is your firm foundation. Today, that's what we want to focus on, is who is Jesus Christ? What did he accomplish by going to the cross? And what did he do when he left that tomb? Because we tend to focus on the death on the cross, but we need to focus on the life after the tomb, amen? And so we're going to talk about that today in a part two of the revelation of the tomb. This morning, I just want you to set your affections on him. Let's just get rid of all the things that are weighing you down. And let's just enter that presence, that peace, that joy. Let's just enter with thanksgiving. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning that we can come gather together in a building, Lord God, that is provided by you with electricity and with good technology. But, Lord, none of that stuff really matters because we want to just focus on you today with the work of the cross, the empty tomb, and what you have for your people. Lord Jesus, we ask you to come into this place. And we ask you, Lord, to receive the worship as we give it up to you. May it be a sweet incense. May it be an aroma holy and pleasing unto you. And Lord God, we just thank you for the Holy Spirit. I thank you that you sent us the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Counselor. And Lord, that he is with us right here, with us right now. Holy Spirit, we invite you to be a part of the prayer. We invite you to be a part of what we're doing here as we wake in the Revival Center with these people today. Lord God, we want to honor you with our praise. We want to bless your name today. For the name of Jesus is high and lifted up. Come on, people, you got to start joining in here. His name is high and lifted up. He is worthy of all praise. He is worthy of all glory. He is worthy of all honor. He is worthy of all power. There's no other name given under heaven but the name of Jesus Christ. And at his name, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So, Lord, right now we take dominion over every unclean thought, everything that tries to set itself and exalt itself up against you. Lord, we bring you low right now. We say, Lord, have your way today. Lord, we surrender ourselves to you. And we say, Lord God, that here we are today to commune with you. And Lord, as we worship, may the praises go up and be received. May it be a fine instrument. May it be a holy aroma before you. And may it be received as an offering, as a token of how much we love you today, and how much we thank you for the sacrifice, and how much we thank you for the work of the cross that bore the sin, that bore the sickness, that bore the shame, that took it all and set us free. And Lord, I thank you that those who are set free are free indeed. So today, Lord, we just use that freedom to rejoice in the great name of Jesus Christ. We use that freedom to praise your name. We use that freedom to be joyful. We use that freedom to dance before the Lord. For Lord God, I thank you that you have done it. It is finished in the name of Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you. pretty exciting, pretty jumpy, pretty. And you're probably going to get a drink of water because it goes right in. Thank you. Thank you.
Comes in the praise, amen. For he is Hosanna, and he is high and lifted up. Well, shake hands about 100 people while you're here, and enjoy yourself for the transition. Just have fun with it. Resurrection Sunday. It's a great time to be alive, amen. Beautiful day, great weather, God is good. Somebody's taking a test. I mean, where the test is. So last week we talked about the revelation of the truth. You have to understand who God is to know where He's taking you. In order for you to trust His plan, you have to have an understanding of who He is, amen? You have to understand that He has good things in store for you, that He has the best plans, the best purposes, plans to build up, not tear down, plans to bless His business, a life more abundantly. And so you have to have a revelation of who the King is. So to have that revelation, you have to have an open mind and understand what the Bible says about who the King is, amen? I say this. He's God of life. Aren't you thankful for that? He's a good God. Listen, we talked yesterday about our last week, called One Revelation 10, but I want to focus, I'm trying to focus on after the cross. We talked a lot about the cross. Amen. Hallelujah. I love the cross. That's where my redemption came from, is the blood of Jesus Christ. But then is the tomb. And then is the resurrection and the empty tomb. But what happens after that? He ascended to the high place, amen. First he went to the low place, took the keys of death and Hades. Then he ascended to the high place, sat down at the right hand of the Father, and the once for all sacrifices for sin was made. Do you agree with that? Sound pretty biblical, right? But when he left, I want to talk about the torn veil. Because it affects you. And what it does, the reason that veil broke, it was torn. We submit the relationship with God by not failing. Amen. So let's just pray as we run through the word time. So, Heavenly Father, Holy Spirit, I ask you right now just to bring revelation to all of us. The love, the joy of the Lord, the peace of God, the great things on our hands, the plan that you have for us. Give us a fresh revelation of how much you love us and care about us. That Jesus, it wasn't just the death on the cross, it wasn't just taking the keys of death and Hades. The Lord, when you send us to the right hand of the Father, you send us the Comforter, the Counselor, and the Holy Spirit to help guide us through this life. And Lord, we want to be good. But the Lord, let your word bring forth and speak out to us. Lord, we love you so much. We thank you. And we want to bless you, Jesus Christ. We want to say thank you, Lord God, for all you've done. And bless this word today. Do you understand what I said? And then we get some communion today, the 30 day for communion. I haven't done that in a little while, so. Resurrection. You know they don't call it Easter. I did it on purpose. I think you're not going to like this, but Easter is really not taking as it's okay. So we just kind of got away from that. I want to make it resurrection. Because it's not about Easter. You saw what Joe Biden did. I'm sure it wasn't Joe Biden. He's like transgender illumination day. That guy was desperate. He's desperate. I mean, look at the desperate play they're at with. The people of God are starting to awaken. The curse is arising, and what's happening is the devil's playing every hand he's got, and he's like, whoa, let's take this and try to get him out. He's trying to offend the people of God. He's trying to create division. There's enough of that in the church already, amen. We need to get kind of past the division. We need to forgive other people. So if they hurt you, forgive them. They hurt Jesus too. Forgive them. Let it go. No matter what happened, let it go. But when Jesus died, because there was a curtain in the temple. And the curtain was to separate the holy from the most holy. And only once a year could a priest go in there and give the sacrifice in the most holy place. And he better be purified, because if he enters the most holy place, he may not come back out. They had to put little bells on him and a rope to pull him back out if he wasn't sanctified to the Lord. They didn't have the blood of Jesus back there, they had the blood of both of them. To satisfy the requirements of sin, amen. And so, we have this curtain in the temple that separated the holy from the most holy, from the temple to Gentiles and the basic access to God directly. And that's all I want to focus about today. So let's turn to Mark 15, 37 to 38. If you're taking notes, we're going to talk about the natural veil right now, the natural veil. Mark 15, 37 Mark 15 says, when Jesus uttered another loud cry, this is when he's on the cross, he breathed his last, and a curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two. Listen, this part's very important, from top to bottom. Not from bottom to top, it was from top to bottom. Luke, in Luke 23, 44, says, by this time it was about noon. We have a time frame here. The darkness fell across the whole land. It was quick. I don't know what it was. The darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. So it was quite a few hours of darkness there, 3 hours to get out. And the light from the sun was gone. And suddenly, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn down the middle. Then he shouted, Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands. And with these words, he breathed his last. And so we have two accounts. One says it happened after Jesus died, and one says it happened before Jesus died. Doesn't really matter because they didn't have the tech, they didn't have security cameras in place to find out exactly what happened. They wouldn't know in the temple when Jesus died on the cross, okay? So we just want to go to the past these little things that we make big deals about. It's like, they didn't know which place he died first, we died after the temple was done. They didn't know. And the fact is, the reason why the curtain was torn is because when Jesus died, he finished the sacrifice once and for all. He said, now it is finished. He said, it is finished. It is finished. It is finished. No longer sacrifice for sin has to be made by the blood of broken bones. Why? Jesus being dead, to get rid of the sacrifice for us, for the Israel. They're trying to bring back the sacrificial system that was destroyed 2,000 years ago. Temple, this is important to know, is that the temple was 30 by 30 by 30. So it was 30 feet high. No man could reach the top of that curtain. The curtain was probably 4 inches thick, made out of the best of our understanding, made out of cloth. And you can get it with a phone book like a curtain. And you certainly couldn't get to the top to stretch from top to bottom. It had to be done by God, because God does what he can't do. There's nothing ways for you to do things he wants you to do. God makes a way so that you can do what you're called to do. He already paid the price. He already set your path. He already put you in motion. All you have to do is be loyal to the plan. Just be obedient to the plan for obedience is better than sacrifice. I'm talking to a few people this morning on live stream. Not you guys, but you did it. I can see the right place going out there. So Herod's temple in this day, it's kind of interesting because Herod's temple, this is not Solomon's temple in all glory. This is a rebuilt temple by Herod, but Herod built a really nice temple. He put a lot of money, a lot of effort here because he wanted to make sure he had the world view of the Jews around him. And so his temple was beautiful, but it's missing a few key ingredients like the Ark of the Covenant. Because that disappeared in 586 BC when the Babylonian invasion came in. And so the Ark of the Covenant was no longer discovered during the time frame. They did not have the Ark of the Covenant in Herod's temple. Kind of interesting. We've heard us talk about this before, but I believe it's 100% because the lines of blue, the scripture, is from why it discovered the Ark of the Covenant. And it found blood and secret judgment on top of it. And it makes sense because where it was located was under God's temple. He didn't know. He said there's a crack in the ceiling. I see the crack. I can see stained blood stains. But you know, thousands later it'll be dark. But the blood is living. You can watch the video. It's amazing. I won't rehash it here. But the fact is that when Jesus died, this is how God does everything exactly the way he says he's going to do it. You can trust him with your life because he had to make the final sacrifice once for all for sin. He was the sinless lamb. So when his blood ran down the cross, it ran into a cross hole that was probably 4 feet deep. And as the blood ran down, the soldier team, instead of breaking his legs, stuck him with a spear. And instead of sudden flow of blood and water gushed out. Well, where did it go? It went down the cross hole, filled up the cross hole until it was overflowing. And then suddenly there was an earthquake. And the earthquake shook that Golgotha. And it formed a crack at the base of the cross hole. And the blood dripped onto the Ark of the Covenant, making a once and for all sacrifice for sin. That's how God works. So you're an amen. If somebody get excited, come on. Is it just me? Because God is that good. He's going to do exactly what he says he will do. He's going to do things the way he says he's going to do in the last days. Amen? He's going to do things the way he spoke through the prophets and the apostles. He's going to do things that he says in the Word. You can trust him in this. That he will do what he said he would do. If it's in here, you can bank on it as the truth, and God put it in here because it is the inspired Word of God. Let's get back to the Bible. Amen. Hebrews 9:23. That is why the tabernacle. That is why the tabernacle and everything in it were the top of what's ahead. And had to be purified by the blood of animals. But the real things in heaven had to be purified with far better sacrifices than the blood of animals. For Christ did not enter into a holy place made with human hands, which was only a copy of the true one in heaven. For what is it? He entered into heaven itself to appear now before God on our behalf. And he did not enter himself, heaven to him, offer himself again and again, like the high priest here on earth, who entered the most holy place year after year with the blood of an animal. If that had been necessary, Christ would have had to die again and again ever since the world began. But now, once for all time, hallelujah, once for all time, he has appeared at the end of the age to remove sin by his own death as a sacrifice. And just as each person is destined to die once. There's no reincarnation, people. You don't get a second chance at this life. You better make the best of it while you're here. And after that comes the judgment. So also Christ was offered once for all time as a sacrifice to take away the sins of many people. He will come again, not to deal with our sins, but to bring salvation to all who are eagerly waiting for him. His own blood dripped on the ark of the covenant, and it was a type of shadow that was in heaven. Revelation 11:19 says, then in heaven the temple of God was opened, and the ark of his covenant could be seen inside the temple. There's an ark inside the temple. The one on earth was a type of shadow of what was in heaven. It was a copy of what was in heaven. Lightning flashed, thunder crashed and roared, and there was an earthquake and a terrible hailstorm. See, Moses saw the ark that was in heaven to build it. When he was on Mount Sinai, he saw the ark and built an exact copy of the ark. What God says is going to do with you. And these times, in these last days, it is important to line up with what God says to do. And I can promise you this, the life outside of the Word of God is much better than the life on the other side. The grass is not greener. It looks greener, but the devil offers that temptation. Hey, look how much good it is over here. In fact, he tries to get a lot of people off track just by keeping our heads down and not looking up for the prize. But we're in such a day and such a time that we'll talk about this next week, but there are so many signs coming. I think the rapture is a tribulation. I don't think so right now, but it is definitely one. It is definitely a sign that it's time for the people of God to rise up. It's time for the people to make a stand for righteousness. What you're seeing with this release of the transgender illumination energy is all about challenging the people of God. It's about common experience. And he's waiting for some people of God to take a hold of it and stand on that common and say, if God is God, then let fire come down from heaven and look up the sacrifice. If God be God, what God got to tell you today is God is God. That he will do what he said he would do. And he needs some people that will carry his word with authority, with power, and will call down the name of the Lord. Call down signs and wonders and miracles. He's equipped you and he's gifted you with the ability to lay hands on the sick and he will recover it. He's gifted you with the ability to pray the prayer of faith and that person, whatever they need, will receive it. He's gifted you to do it. Jesus is in heaven. The Holy Spirit's down here. Because he's gathered right here in the fire. So he's coming to visit somebody. But his job is to let the Holy Spirit do his job. And the Holy Spirit is here right now. And I really feel like it's time to start walking in signs and wonders and miracles. It's time to start believing God for the bigger things instead of worrying just about your own life, about what you wear, about what you eat, about the job, about the finances. Oh, sure, it's easy for me to say that I've been through some stuff. I've been through all the things that everyone else has. It's like, yeah, if you turn to God, he will turn to you. If you come close to God, he'll come close to you. But God's always there, but you have to make the, you have to make a decision to say, God, I'm just going to follow you no matter what the cost. I've got verses for that. Everything I've got today, I've got a verse for it. And Hebrews 10 says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place. See, because that curtain was torn in two, because the access was granted to you to come into the most holy of holy of holy of holy places to be right there with God, because you're covered by the sin, your sin's covered by the blood of Jesus. Amen? And so He wants you to come in, but most of us are too afraid to enter that holy of holies. We're like, well, we're going to stay on the court of the Gentiles. We're going to stay right out here. I'll go to church once a week. I'll pray when I get to church. I'll do that when I get to church, Lord. He's looking for someone who's going to follow Him daily, because you have to sacrifice daily to your flesh. Amen? You can't just let it build up and try to dump it all one time, because you'll have a little build-up all during the week. You're like, that's the worst week I've ever had. But it says, enter the holy place through the blood of Jesus Christ. He made the way. That's why it's so important right now. I love the cross, but I love access. Access is everything. Presence is everything. Nothing else matters. When you're in the presence of God, everything you worried about falls away, because worries are the flesh. See, when you're in the presence of God, the supernatural is rising up inside, and you're able to do things that you never thought you could do before. You're able to trust and believe God for things you never thought you could believe for. He'll give you ideas. He'll give you plans. He'll give you things that you need to do in His presence, in the Holy Spirit. But if you never go there, if you never use the access, you'll never get the privilege. You'll never have privileges. You'll never know what He has for you until you can enter the most holy of holies. And you don't have to do it by ritual. You don't have to do it by sacrifice. All you have to do is come down humbly and say, Lord, I need You. I want to hear Your voice today. Because He made a way when that temple curtain was torn. And so by His death, Jesus opened a new and, listen, a life-giving way. Life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. Because the natural curtain was torn, the spiritual curtain was also rent. Because you can go right into access to God. There's no more veil covering who God is. The mystery of God is being revealed right now. You don't have to wonder who God is. You can enter in and ask Him yourself. It's not my job, it's not anybody else's job to do it for you. You do not need a high priest or a mediator to do what God has called you to do directly by His sacrifice. And don't think that you have to wait for somebody else to lead you into the Holy of Holies, because you need to enter into the blood with thankfulness and worship. Amen? And so since we have a high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God. We can go right into the presence of God. Cares for me. It died on that cross for my sin, so I can go into His presence. I can. Allah doesn't do that. Allah would rather take your head off your body. Allah would rather have you kill a bunch of people and then give you 70 virgins. Allah doesn't do love. Buddha doesn't do love. Elohim does love. Yeshua does love. Yet took him to the cross. But the work wasn't finished at the cross. It was finished when He took the keys of death of Hades and the right hand of the Father and sent the comfort of the gospel of the Holy Spirit. When He did that, He made a way for us to come and ask for anything we need. He made a way for us to do miracle signs and wonders in the name of the Father, in the name of Yeshua, in Jesus Christ's name. But we're worried about what other people think. Or we're about our faith being so small that we can't do it. You're right. We can't do it. We can't. But because you have access to the Holy of Holies, you have access to the presence of God. Because you have access to the presence of God, you become a threat. You are literally a terroristic threat to the divine kingdom. God has got you on assignment. You may not see it yet, but this is your wake-up call, because the trumpet's about to sound. Amen? There's a trumpet blowing. It says, my people, you know, the trumpet is so far. It was there to wake people up and say, it's time for war. But you know what God said? The battle is mine, says the Lord. But we have to call and be obedient, and we have to do the work that He's called us to do. And until we do, we're not going to see anything happen. We're going to wait for somebody else to do it and say, I'm sending you. I'm sending you. I'm sending you. So let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting Him. Will you trust Him today? Will you say, Lord, I trust you with the situation? Will you say, Lord, I can't do it myself anymore? Because the more you try to do it, the more you fail. Been there, done that. There used to be an old commercial back in probably the 80s about cocaine. We talked about that, too. And this guy was like, I have to make more money. So he does cocaine. So he can work longer hours. So he can make more money. So he can buy more cocaine. So he can work longer hours. Do you guys, do you know anyone ever saw that commercial? Thank you, Mike. How somebody goes, you can't do it. You don't get to want it done. There's a problem now. This thing's just come and go. So our guilty consciousness have been sprinkled with Christ's blood. Don't you dare think you're not worthy. Don't you dare think that you're under condemnation or guilt or shame. Oh, this happened in the past and I'm still suffering for that. You know, let it go. Let it go. Let it go. Like that Frozen song. Lacey with it. How's that song go? I love that song.
This place is bigger and better. We can sprinkle with Christ's blood that is clean, and our bodies have been washed with pure water. Our challenge today is to come to the Father. He's calling you to come to Him. And repent of your transgressions and come through the veil. There's no more veil. There's no more curtain. No priest to save you from your sins. No minister, no pastor. No, you have access directly. You know where you're at. You know what you need. Guess what? So does God. So no surprise. You're not going to embarrass God. Ooh, I didn't know you did all that. So he knows everything you do.
Everything. The thoughts of man are laid bare open before the Lord came. Matthew 27. Let's see what that prayer. Let's take it here at the crucifixion. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. At about 3 o'clock, Jesus called out with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you abandoned me? See, at that moment, he took on the sins of the entire world. He died so fast, he said, wow, he died really fast on that cross. That's because the weight of sin that you've done, the weight of sin that I've done, all became on Jesus Christ. And he became the curse, so we may not be under the curse. And he died. Like that, he said, God, why have you forsaken me? Because God can't be around sin. And I'm going to tell you something today, that if you're dabbling in sin, you're going to have a hard time running to the presence of God. Because it's the holy place. That's the most holy place. And when the old priest had to go in, he would get killed for God to say he wasn't holy. But when you go in by the blood of the Lamb, you go in clean. You go in spotless. He's a good God. He wants you in there. He wants you in the presence. He wants you in the holy place. He made a way for you, for me, for all of us. I just saw the bystanders misunderstood. God is calling for the prophet Elijah. But one of them ran and filled his sponge with sour wine, holding up to him on a reed stick so they could drink. But the rest said, wait, let's see whether Elijah comes to save him. Then Jesus shouted out again and released his spirit. And at that moment, the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook. The rocks split apart. The tombs opened. And the bodies of many godly men and women who had died were raised from the dead. We don't talk about that much. How about that freak you out? The first priest of the resurrection were going out back into the city. And then it was before Jesus' resurrection. It was these people were the first fruit. Jesus went down. These guys came out of the tomb. That's pretty freaky. You thought Lazarus was a crazy story. What if you see a whole bunch of your family members coming back out of the tomb? It's like, whoa, what happened? Don't talk about that much. That's pretty wild to think about, though. You know, I don't think it's a tomb. Because it was a testimony of what Jesus was going to do. Jesus always has to do with this. And so they left the cemetery after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city, Jerusalem, and appeared to many people as witnesses.
Hebrews 10, it says under the Old Covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sin. Could you imagine being a priest back in the old days before Jesus? What a job! All day long, man, you were killing animals, and you were cutting animals, and you were cutting altars, and you were sprinkling blood, I mean, all day long, because you can't stop sinning. I'm not saying you, I'm just saying people in general. It's like, you get away from the people who are coming. It doesn't mean you keep on sinning. No. It's a good thing to
know. If you die, take away your sin once and for all, but not be to keep on sinning because then it's going to be crucified Jesus over and over again.
The Bible says that. If you got to stop doing what you're doing. If you ask for forgiveness, quit doing it. After a while, you're not asking for forgiveness, you're asking for permission. That's a good quote from him. But our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sin, good for all time. Then he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand. There he waits, listen, there he waits. So Jesus is waiting. There he waits in heaven at God's right hand until his enemies are humbled and made a footstool under his feet. When does that happen?
And he said, coming.
So he's in heaven right now. For by that one offering is made forever perfect, those who are being made holy. See, your holiness is continual.
Being perfect.
Sorry.
The cloak is. Thank you.
But we're all working. We all make mistakes. Don't let these mistakes keep you away from your brothers and sisters. Keep you away from God. The Holy Spirit also testifies that this is so, for he says, this is the new covenant I will make with the people, my people, on that day, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts. I will write them on their minds. Then he says, I will never again remember their sins and lawless deeds. And when sins have been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices. And so, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. And by his death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain. Hallelujah. He opened the curtain. He made a life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. And since we have a great high priest who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God. Hello. Let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him. Will you enter today through worship that you are going into the presence of God Almighty? Don't go by what you see. Use your spirit. Use your imagination. Enter the Holy Place. This is where you find rest. It's the Holy Place you find what you need. It's in that place you find that peace. Because it's a tempest going on all around this right now. And I wish I could say something any better, but it's not. When you get into the celebration, and we see things happening, there's wars and rumors of wars, just like there's breakthroughs in various places. That's what these are, beginning of both days. Not the end of both days, but the beginning of both days. So we'll start to see these things transpire before us. And Jesus says, come into my holy place, and I will give you rest. And take your breath of your life, and give you peace. And the peace of God becomes your approach to this life. There is nothing this world has to offer that compares to the peace of God. The peace of God is amazing. Towards everything, just the Bible. Thank you, Jesus. So, I'm just briefly talking about the second curtain. That was the one. The second curtain is the spiritual temple. You now have direct access to God. You are a supernatural being. You are a spiritual person. 2 Corinthians says, but whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Mm-hmm. And the veil is taken away. You see, clearly. For the Lord is the Spirit, and whatever the Spirit of
the Lord is, there is freedom. Hallelujah. So all of us who have had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of God. All of you who have had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. That is an amazing, powerful little section of Scripture. It's 2 Corinthians 3, 16-18. You're going to want to write that down. You're going to want to refer to that in the future because you're reflecting the glory of God. See, when Moses went into the presence of God, he said his face shone like the glory of God. They can even look at him like, oh, put a veil over your face. See, the world doesn't like it. The world wants to veil the presence of God. They can't look the holiness in you. And so when people say things about you and do things against you and come against you, it's because they can't stand the holiness that God has in you. Don't take it personal. Don't take offense. Understand that you're drawing near to God, and some people aren't going to do it go with you. Not everyone can walk the road that you're called to walk on. And so don't try to hold on to bring people with you. Focus on your path that He's called you to go. Because sometimes the world doesn't want to see the holiness of God on you because it can make them very strong and run their life with you. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him. Amen. Spirit, make us more and more like You. It's like prayer. Satan blinds the mind of the unbeliever. 2 Corinthians 4. If the good news we preach is hidden behind the veil, it is hidden only from the people of God who are perishing. Satan, therefore, who is the God of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this message about the glory of Christ and the exact blindness of God. Don't you ever give up praying for the lost, because their minds are blinded. They are blinded by the God of this world. Satan, who is the God of this world, has blinded them. When you come across people who just want to, like, just punch them in the Bible, punch them in the face of the Bible, you can't, because they're blinded. It's a spiritual warfare. You have to pray because the God of this world has blinded their mind. And that's what we're seeing. It's not a battle against transgenders and Christians. It's a battle against the God of this age who has blinded the minds of the unbeliever. His name is Satan, Lucifer, the devil, known by several different names, but he's a punk. But he's about to get whooped by the church. I want to say about the ark, I want to say about the church, the ecumenical church of God. And it's about time for the people to rise. Are you guys with me on that? I know there's a lot going on here. You know, it's cloudy, and I'm almost kind of falling asleep, but it's okay. It's going to get all fucking. We're getting through it, but the exciting news is that it's on. And you can't shrink back. You have to move forward. Unfortunately, you've been drafted into the King's army, and you have to move again. You can't just stand back as you get defeated. You have to take ground. The church has been losing ground for decades, and we've been defeated and pushed back, and we're finally in the corner. And guess what? People will fight their fiercest when they're back into your corner. When there's nowhere else to go, you're going to fight your fiercest opponent right there. It's about time for the church of God to rise. It's time for you to rise. It's time for you to rise. It's time for all of us to take a stand for what's right. That involves prayer. I'm sad that on Wednesday, I'm out of town, so I'm not there. There's only 3 people here, 4 people in the prayer. Because prayer is a weapon that destroys strongholds. Prayer is our weapon. It's our armor, it's our protection, it's our defense, and coupled with the sword of the Spirit, it breaks down opposition, barriers, walls, and defenses. But until we become a praying church, we're not going to see a victory. Because victory comes through prayer. You have to, no soldier goes out to battle. They don't put it through, you know, 2 days of training on how to operate a tank and say, okay, go out there and go into battle. What to do. That's what most of our believers in church are. They don't know what to do. We're trying to equip people to know what to do. Amen. We're just sitting here doing this. This is the word of God. This is the meat. This is something that's going to be accessed and used to battle, because no matter what, you're part of it. Even if you don't want to be, well, you're going to be part of it. You got that. Because the war is going to win. You can't stand back. belongs to yourself. It's more of a threat than what you see. Because you're not belonging to yourself, but God wants to have Christ, and you must turn around with your body. You must turn around with your body. Don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God lives in you? Once the curtain was torn, that got rid of the natural order of sacrifice. That abolished. Jesus came to fulfill the law, not to abolish the law. He fulfilled it, and his blood became the way that way to sacrifice once and for all. But because he did that, now we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. That's why it's important not to wait for me or somebody else for look at people and like you or the temple of the Holy Spirit with direct access to the presence of God. And every time that you can open up the Word of God, you can pour into people with direct access to another community you access. And the more you do it, the more access you get, the deeper you go into the spiritual realms and supernatural realms of heaven, the deeper you get into the supernatural realms of heaven, the less this light means to you. The less this light means to you, the more threat you are against the demonic. The more threat you are against the demonic, the more you start to pray for other people. The more you start to pray for other people, the more yokes are broken. The more yokes are broken, the more people receive the same thing that you receive. The more people receive the same thing that you receive, becomes a new army of God rising up. A new army of God rising up takes the place of the old people that never really did anything, but then the new army comes and it takes back the ground that the church is lost, and then we start to feel spotless bride of Jesus Christ. And the only way to make the bride spotless is going to be a firm shaking. The only way to make the bride come back up alive and wake up from the slumber is to be shaken. I try to wake up my son by yelling at him, Caleb! Nothing. I have to shake that dude. I have to shake him violently. If I go like this, nothing. Caleb, wake up! If you're ready, there's a church that's going to work. There's very few churches out there anymore that are uncompromised. You can see how popular it is. Look around. We've got 25 people. You see how popular the message is. True. Am I the only one? No, there's a bunch of churches there. But guess what? They're going to be empty too. Because the world is speaking what they want to hear. And what they want to hear is they can go and sin like they've been doing. And there's no punishment for that. They can still be the same carnal Christian and still get to heaven. But I'm telling you the truth today that you cannot continue to do what you're doing and enter into heaven. You can't say, God be my Savior, and then go back and do the exact same thing over and over again because the Bible clearly says you're crucified. Now, I agree with grace. I'm all about grace. But grace doesn't cover your inability to stop sinning. It covers your connection that God is always there with you. But His blood doesn't cover your sin unless you put sin in. It's time for people to be holy. It's not holiness, it's not to be holy. So we deliberately, dear friends, if we deliberately continue sinning after we have received knowledge of the truth, there is no longer any sacrifice that will cover these sins. You hear what I'm saying? Not for you guys, for the life thing, people. I'm telling you. But this goes out to other people, so you know, I don't know where they're at. And there is only the terrible expectation of God's judgment and the raging fire that will consume His enemies. He is talking to the people of the church right here. He's not talking to the sinners and the unbelievers and the vile and the ungodly and the drunkards and the murderers and those people. He said, dear friends, He's talking to the church. If we deliberately continue sinning after we receive this knowledge, there's no longer a sacrifice left for your sin. For anyone who refused to obey the law of Moses was put to death without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses, By the way, this is Hebrews chapter 10. This is the New Testament teaching. Just think how much worse the punishment will be for those who have trampled on the Son of God and have treated the blood of the covenant, which made us holy, as if it were common and unholy, and have insulted and disdained the Holy Spirit who brings God's mercy to us. For the other one who said, I will take revenge and I will pay them back. He also said, the Lord will judge his own people. It is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. It's time to wake up and live a holy life. It's the reason why we're in the problems we are, mostly because we made it. We want to blame the devil. We want to blame the world. Sometimes we just want to blame God. Fact is, we caused our own problem. We self-fulfilled what we're blaming other people that did to us. I say this because forgiveness is so important. As the scriptures say, God has put them into a deep sleep. To this day, he has shut their eyes, and they do not see, and close their ears, and they do not hear. Ephesians says, but their evil intentions will be exposed, and the light shines on them. The world needs to see your light, for the light makes everything visible. That is why it is said, awake, O sleeper, rise up from the dead, and Christ will give you light, living by the Spirit's power. Sounds like fun. How many of you want to live by the Spirit of God? 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 55, 56, this way, hallelujah, thank you, songs, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. That's not what it says for you to do. It's not that word. It's not a fun word, but it is encouraging. Because you need a way to do it. Whatever you've been going through, you don't do it anymore. You can enter the most holy of holies. Direct access to the presence of God. That power is going on. Do you know what else can give you? Strategy, ideas, vision, favor. If you allow him to talk to you, to give you that time to minister to you, he will open up new doors of opportunity for you. So whatever you're struggling with, whatever you're having a problem with, don't keep talking about it and keep doing nothing. Get into the holy place. Because then God will deal with it. Because God said it's mine to be part of this world. It's mine to be this. We are always confident that though we don't pray about as long as we live, these bodies, we are not at home with the Lord. So we live by believing. The third and final curtain that we destroy is death. And I'm thankful for that. What I'm saying to your brothers and sisters that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Don't worry about whether you're cremated or whether you're in a casket. It doesn't matter because the physical body isn't going to heaven anyway. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust, it ain't who you are. It's just a little thing. It's like, hey, take off a pair of pants. Because the spirit's inside of you, and your mind on the most, it gives you a resurrected body. If you want to read more about it, read 1 Corinthians 15, which I'm in right now. I'm going to get into the new transformed body, but it's pretty amazing. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. These decaying things cannot inherit the eternity that God has. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. Hallelujah. That's exciting right there. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. And when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live together and forever. And we who are living will also be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then while when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death. And the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. So my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. always work enthusiastically for the Lord. So you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever good. Jesus shouted out again and released the Spirit at the moment of equipment of the sanctuary of the temple of 22. And his tombs opened. And he went to the temple of Jesus' resurrection with the Holy Spirit. Verse 54, the Roman officer and the other soldiers, the crucifixion were terrified to hear his voice and all that had happened. And so, this man truly was the Son of God. Truly, this man was the Son of God. When he died, there was no denying that Jesus was the Son of God. There's darkness fell on the land. The earth shook. The temple curtain was torn from top to bottom. It was very evident that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. The people came out of their tombs as the first fruits of the resurrection. It was very clear that Jesus paid the ultimate price and was the Son of God. Any voice just come close to God. God will come close to you. Today, you come close to God. You stand for the prayer of your bucket and try to sit in there. I'm going to sing our last words of song. Before we do, I'm going to ask God and Sandy if you guys come up here and do a speech to me. While we're singing the song, what we'd like to do is have you come up and take the elements. Yes, and join us. So while they're singing, I want you to take this time to just reflect what it means to come close to God. Because some of you here have no idea what that means. There's no good for it, there's no formula. It's simply saying, Jesus, I trust you with my life. And Lord God, I want to be with you at present. Speak to me. And what I need, I say, speak to your servant, Lord, right and listening. God wants to speak to you. He wants to talk to you. He wants to be your friend. He wants to be your redeemer. He wants to be your deliverer. He wants to be your provider. He wants to be your healer. But you got to let him do that and you have to make time for him.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
Waiting for you to make a decision. He's always calling. He's always talking. And he's looking for this frequency. You have to tune in to what he's saying. And he's always talking to you. He's always telling you how much he loves you and how valuable you are. But today, if you're feeling an illness in your body, he said that this flesh is broken. I was fine between the curse and what the curse. And that by his stripes you are healed. He as you take this today, I want you just to believe. That's all he asks you to do is believe. It's the hardest thing to do because it's contrary to your mind. But believe today that that sacrifice for your body will make you whole. So Lord God, as we take this element today, this representation of the body of the Most High God, Lord, that today may create wellness within our body. Lord, may it straighten out diabetes and unhealthy blood sugars. Lord, may it strengthen backs. May it cause, Lord, organs to operate at peak efficiency. Lord, may even the very blood be transformed to be more Christ-like. So we take this today in remembrance of you. And we thank you for your sacrifice on the cross. A new beginning. It's not a new earth. It's not the same. It's a time to reflect the light that He is showing you. The cup represents His blood, which covers your sin. It creates the outset into the Holy of Holies. His body didn't change the access to his blood to the access. That was, you know, it was always the blood that had to be sacrificed. So today, as you take this cup, know that it's a new day, it's a new covenant, it's a fresh beginning, it's a fresh start. You can go from here and the gospel will hold you back any longer. You can go from here and nothing can stop what God has for you because His plans are to build you up, not tear you down. His plans are to push you back on track. You were derailed from things in the past, but He says, come back in and come closer to me, draw closer to me, and I will draw close to you. I will wrap my arms around you, protect you, lean back and kiss you, and breathe and know that I am God. So if you take this today, this isn't just great juice. This is just a ritual. This is the start of something great in your life. You'll be able to reflect back on this moment. I remember that resurrection Sunday. I'd be waking your revival tonight. No matter where God leads you, no matter what ministry direction He takes you in, no matter where you go, know that He is with you and that He has ordained your steps. And that you're here today, not by chance or accident, but you were brought here by the Spirit of the Most High God. And that behold, it is true, and have been all things new, says the Lord. But thank you. God is good. We're going to sing one last song on video. You guys were dismissed from here. Don't start the song yet. And if you need special prayer, we're here for you. We're going to stay up front, stay behind. Feel free to hang out and talk or go on to your Resurrection Sunday plans. We're pretty loose here. Just do what you got to do, amen? But we're glad you're here. We're glad you came. And I'm really excited to see what God's doing in your life. Because you're bringing testimonies back. So let's sing this last song before we go. I'm just going to dismiss the prayer. Lord God, I thank you for the wonderful people that are here today. And I thank you, Lord, that you are just moving in our lives. And Lord, we thank you that we're able to draw closer to you and into your presence through the blood. And Jesus, we just want more. We just want more of you. Whatever that looks like, however that is, we pray. And I bless these people. May they have the best week they've ever had. Lord, may you go before them, be beside them, even go behind them, Lord God, and bless them in everything they do. I thank you, Lord, that the favor of the Lord rests upon us, that we are the children of the Most High God. I thank you, that, Lord, favor is all around us in Jesus' name. Let's get the same last song here.
Jesus.